Welcome, everybody. My name's Scott. I'm joined by Stephen, and I'd like to welcome our Spark Systems YouTube audience and really appreciate you joining us today. Stephen, I understand we're going to be looking at information models and, in particular, conceptual models. So I was hoping that you might be able to give us a bit of an overview of what a conceptual model is and how it might be used with respect to Enterprise Architect and creating databases. Welcome.
Thank you, Scott. Thanks for the introduction. I'm delighted to be here. Yes, we're going to be talking about the conceptual data model. Why is this model important? Because information or data is almost like a currency or the blood that flows through a system. Information is consumed, it's changed, it's created, and it flows through the system right from the business world right through down into the database world. So it's an important thing to model. The conceptual data model fits into this story as kind of the second thing that would go on in terms of information analysis. The first thing being a glossary, which we've talked about in a previous video, or what might be called a business terms model, where the business are just defining the kind of the terms and the definitions of those terms. But the conceptual data model is the first kind of precursor. It's platform independent. It's got nothing to do with the type of database that you're going to create, whether it's MySQL, SQLite, SQL Server. It's completely independent of those platforms. And it's just describing the kind of things that the business know about and want to describe in this journey of the information modeling. So let's make a start. Previously today, I've been doing some project management work. I've got my perspective set to project management. But what we're going to do is we're going to change that into the UML and all UML, because we're going to be creating what essentially is like a class diagram. So we'll change that perspective. And notice the tool changes its focus. And we've got the builder page that's come up. It's got all sorts of different types of patterns on there that we can start modeling with. We want to do things from first principles, Scott. So we're going to ignore this for the moment, and we're going to start from first principles. So I'll close this builder page. And as always, I need a package to start my information modeling. So I choose the urban parking meter system package. I use the icon in the browser toolbar to create a new package. And I'm going to call this one information models. And then I'm going to create another package called conceptual data model. These are just containers that will contain our elements and connectors that we're going to be putting into the model. Let's move this information model down using the little arrow icons on the browser toolbar, and we'll move it down into this area here after analysis and before these behavioral models. So we've got a container there now, conceptual data model. Let's go and create a diagram here, and we can use the icon again in the toolbar to create a diagram, and let's take that default name. We can change that name if we want, but let's say conceptual data model, create the diagram. It's a class type of diagram that we want to create. And now the tool gives us a blank canvas, and the toolbox has changed its focus to give us a page of class elements and class relationships. We're going to simply drag a class from the toolbox onto the diagram, roughly in the center, and we're going to call it parking meter. Now, you can see that it's written in natural English. We've got spaces there. This is not an opportunity to be writing things in technology speak. This is a model that's for the business. So as always, Scott, we've got our parking meter thing there. Let's put some, do the right thing here and put some notes into that so that people understand what the parking meter is all about. So we'll paste those notes in there. Parking meter is a physical device that monitors and charges for parking. So we've got it there. We'll just change the shape of that a little bit. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to use a stereotype, which is a UML mechanism for creating a type. So if you work in the airline industry, you might create an aircraft type. If you work in the insurance industry, you might create a claim. In this particular world, we want to create a conceptual modeling entity. So what we do is we go to the settings ribbon, and we choose UML type. So the settings ribbon, the reference data panel, the UML types item, drop that down, and we've got stereotypes, tag values, and cardinalities there. We want to create a new stereotype and just put the conceptual one in. And the class there of class, and we'll put these notes in here, and we'll save that and make sure that that has gone in there. You can see it this time. Let's close that, and let's now go back and reapply that stereotype. So there you can see now the conceptual entity is there. We need a logical entity anyway for a future video, so there's no harm done there. We'll use that one in a later video. Got our conceptual entity though. Let's move along with that. And we've got our parking meter there. So you can see
the stereotype is displayed now on the element in the brackets up above.
Yeah, that's right. It's got the it's there. And let's create another element now. Now, one of the things that we might have obviously is another element, and let's call it vehicle. A vehicle is kind of a another part of our model, and you know the business people would understand that you know what a vehicle is, and have probably lots of discussions about you know what that is. Is it you know can it be a truck, a car, a motorcycle? All sorts of discussions about that, I'm sure. So let's put some notes in here. So a vehicle is any automobile or motor vehicle that occupies a parking space. All of those are there. Now let's create a relationship between these two things, the vehicle and the parking meter. So what we can do is either use the quick linker there, the drag and drop, or we can use the toolbox. Let's do it from the toolbox. Let's put that in, and we can see that we've got a relationship there. So, you know, what is the relationship between the vehicle and the parking meter? So what we can do now is set some multiplicities. And so we go over to the properties window with the relationship selected. We look at the multiplicity here. And let's say this is the vehicle end. Let's say that a vehicle has got a 0-1 relationship with a parking meter. A parking meter has got 0-1 multiplicity with a vehicle. So
does that mean every parking meter can have a certain number of vehicles, or does it mean a vehicle can have a certain number of parking meters?
Yeah, interesting, Scott. We read them like this. We say, look, let's keep the parking meter to one, and it says, let's imagine the multiplicity is one, and how many vehicles can be related to this parking meter, and only one of them at one time, and a vehicle can only be related to a single parking meter. Now we might change that, and the business rules might change, and someone say, look, you know, a parking meter might be broken, so it might be related to multiple meters, and you don't need to, you know, there might be meters that can apply to, you know, multiple different spaces. So we could change that, and we can just very easily do that and say a vehicle is related to multiple parking meters, and put that multiplicity in and save that. So they're not things that you know that are just made up arbitrarily. There's going to be lots of discussions, important discussions, with the business people and the subject matter experts that know all about this. So what we've got is this model now. And the other thing we need to do is we need to set this one as a conceptual entity as well. So we'll do that. And we can now, you know, make these guys the same using our layout. I'll just select that one there, choose the layout ribbon, and say, you know, make same height and width. Now, Scott, a lot of people will find the UML default notation a little bit more difficult to understand. And so we have the option in the diagram to go to the diagram properties and set the connector notation. And in my experience, my consulting experience, I find that people find that information engineering display is much easier for them to understand. So the little crow's feet here, as it's called, tells us that a vehicle can be related to multiple parking meters. And the little ellipse thing here says that it's optional. And the stroke there means that it can be related to one vehicle. So,
but the underlying information hasn't changed, just the way you're displaying that connector notation.
Yeah, that's exactly right, Scott. The underlying information hasn't changed. It's just a presentation, and we can flick it back at any point that we want. I can go back to that display or back to the information engineering one. So that's the beginning of the model. And of course, we can put in, you know, other entities. So let's just put a couple more in. So a parking meter belongs to a parking zone. It's a common kind of concept in the parking meter system, that a parking meter will be in a zone, and the zone will have particular characteristics. So again, we can use these alignment indicators here to say that one's aligned vertically. And again, we can just very quickly set the conceptual entity as a stereotype. So, and again, we can drag a connector. Let's do it with the quick linker this time, and let's drag it up there, and we'll say we want an association. And let's now just again set those source and target multiplicities. So the parking meter one is going to have, well, let's choose the target one, the parking zone. That's going to be let's make that a hard one. And the source one, let's make this going to be an optional parking meter can zone, can apply to multiple parking meters. There we go. So we've set those, and you can see that those indicators come on. Again, we can just set the same size, line those up again. So that's the beginning of the conceptual model. And, you know, remember, don't forget this, this is an important thing. We're going to, you know, create the descriptions of these elements. So with the parking meter there, with parking zone created, and the other one was the vehicle. I think we've done the vehicle as well. So there we have those beginning of our conceptual model. Scott, at this point, I might ask you to perform some magic, and we'll you know, get busy and complete this model.
Well, Stephen, I've performed a little bit of magic, and we've now completed our conceptual model. So I understand, because it's a conceptual model, we're not talking about a particular technology. So I'm assuming, as a consultant, that you could take this conceptual model and then use it on a whole lot of different databases, or it could be completely independent of technology at this point in time.
Yeah, that's right, Scott. The passage that the evolution that it will go through is that the conceptual model will be converted into a logical model, and then the logical into a physical model. And of course, we'll be looking at those things in future videos. But you're completely right there. The conceptual model is a completely independent model that kind of belongs to the business. It's halfway ground between business and the beginning of the analysis, or, you know, technology. But there's no reference in here to any type of platform, you know, any kind of database warehouse or database management system, whether it's a, you know, a SQL database or an XML database. None of that is important at all. What's important is that the important business concepts and their relationships are described. Now, that's where it's different from a glossary or a business terms model, which typically doesn't talk very much about the relationships. But this model started to talk about those relationships. You start to need to make the hard decisions about, you know, what's happening with the model. You have to think about time in here. So, you know, that's what the model's about. And if we look at this, if we had a you know, glossary model in here, we'll start to see some glossary things that will come through in our in our model as well. So that will be an interesting thing to look at in a future video, the relationship between this model and a glossary. The other thing to note, Scott, is and this is somewhat of a moot point between people doing conceptual data modeling, you notice that there aren't any attributes or any properties in here. We haven't talked about, you know, the type of the parking meter. We haven't talked about, you know, the type of the payment or how the payment was made, the transaction date, for example. All of that comes later in the in the logical model. So it's common to leave this out. Occasionally, people will put in some very important business key information. So, you know, they might have something that's in here that they want to put in as a single attribute, but typically they're not attributes in this model.
Right. Well, it's excellent because you can see the relationships between the parking zones, parking meters, the vehicles, the sessions. And I assume there's a great deal of conversation that happens during the modelling process to define these key terms and create appropriate notes and things like that.
Exactly, Scott. So it looks like a relatively simple model, but as you said, a lot of thought would have gone into the model to ensure that it really represents what's going on in this world of the urban parking meter.
Excellent. Well, thanks, Stephen, for showing us a conceptual model and showing us how to build one in Enterprise Architect. I'd like to encourage our audience to like, comment, and subscribe. If you have any questions about conceptual modelling or developing databases within Enterprise Architect, feel free to reach out to Stephen via his website or his LinkedIn details that are in the description of this video. And Stephen, thank you very much for introducing us to conceptual modelling in Enterprise Architect.
Always a pleasure, Scott.